Good evening, good evening. This is Pastor Phil Lewis of the New Mount Pleasant Missionary Baptist Church once again with your Thursday evening discipleship Bible study. We're still in the book of Matthew. We're in the Sermon on the Mount, what I call the Disciples Manifesto. Tonight we'll be looking at, and we're going slow through this, so that we can put the cookies on the bottom shelf where you can even bring your kids and they can get it. Amen? Amen. Tonight we're in chapter 5, verse 6. And I'm going to read it to you from two different versions. First of all, the ESV, the English Standard Version, says this: "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied." They shall be satisfied. Now the NIV says it like this, says it a little different. "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled." Wow, and I'm gonna talk about that little difference in a minute. It's not really a difference, but that interpretation in a minute, why the NIV uses the word filled. I like that particular interpretation there. Hunger and thirst. Hunger and thirst. Let us pray. Father, we thank you. We thank you for your word. We thank you for Jesus the Christ, who saves us, who saved our souls, and who is constantly with us, cleansing us over and over and over again, cleansing us from all unrighteousness. Lord, touch us this evening as we dwell into your word. Reveal yourself to us tonight, that we may be better men, better women, better boys, and better girls. We'll give you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor, not just with our mouths, but most especially with our lives and our behavior. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So, I see you all out there. It's good to see you all on Facebook. God bless you. Hunger and thirst, to have a starving spirit. It is a real hunger and starvation of the soul. It is a parched and dying thirst. It is a starving spirit and a parched soul that craves after righteousness. But there's something more. Righteousness, and this is the difference here between being, they will be filled, they will be satisfied. Righteousness means all righteousness. Wow. The true believer is starved and parched, thirsty for all righteousness. And this is shown by the Greek verbs hunger and thirst are usually in what we call the Greek genitive case. And that simply means that a person sometimes feels a little hunger and a little thirst. Therefore, he hungers and thirsts for a bit of something. For example, you might be hungry and you might just want an apple or a glass of juice. But in the Beatitude, hunger and thirst, in this Beatitude, hunger and thirst are in the accusative case. And this is really unusual. It means a hunger and thirst for the whole thing. It's a hunger and thirst for all righteousness, not for little tidbits, not for little morsels. And this is significant. It means that the promise of a filled life, there's the word, a filled life is conditional. A person must starve and thirst for all righteousness if they wish to be filled with the fullness of life. And listen to these different points here. First of all, who is blessed? The person who hungers and thirsts to be righteous and to do righteousness. Now, just to do righteousness is not enough. Just to be righteous is not enough. Both are essential in order to be blessed. Many want just bits and pieces of righteousness, just enough to make them comfortable. And there are those who stress being righteous and neglect doing righteousness. And that could lead, and you know that could lead to a lot of errors. How are you going to be righteous, but yet not do righteousness? And some people misread Paul when Paul talks about works and faith. You're not saved by your works, you're saved by your faith. But faith, when you look at that word, is a verb. It's an action word. And our belief in Christ calls us to do the works of Christ. Let me say that again. Our belief in Christ causes us and calls us to do the works of Christ. That's some, hopefully y'all writing that one down. There are those who stress being righteous and neglect doing righteousness. And that leads to two serious errors. First of all, the error of false security. It causes a person to stress that they are saved and acceptable to God because they have believed in Jesus Christ. But they neglect doing good. They don't live as they should, obeying God and serving mankind. And then there's the error of loose living. It allows a person to go out and do what they desire. They feel secure and comfortable in their faith in Christ. They know that wrong behavior may affect this, their fellowship with God and other believers, but they think their behavior does not affect their salvation and acceptance with God. But it does. It's just like you can have a great stringed instrument, a great violin, but if the strings are loose, the music sounds horrible. Don't go around with loose strings. You cannot, and I tell preachers this, you can't preach above how you live. If your living is raggedy, your preaching will be raggedy. If your living is loose, your teaching will be loose. And the problem with this is that they're living a false righteousness. Righteousness in the Bible means being righteous and doing righteousness. Both are necessary. The Bible knows nothing about being righteous without doing righteousness, without living righteously. Then there are those who stress doing righteousness and neglect being righteous. This can lead to a serious error also. This is what Paul was talking about, works without faith. Works don't save you. This leads into the error of self-righteousness and legalism. It causes a person to stress that they are saved and acceptable to God because they do good. They work They behave morally. They keep certain rules and regulations. They do the things a Christian should do and obey the main laws of God. But they neglect the basic law, the law of love. The law of love and acceptance. That God loves them and accepts them, not because they do good, but because he loves and trusts the righteousness of Christ that is found only in Christ Jesus. Does that make sense to you? Uh-huh. And then on the other error is a, it causes you to be doing righteousness and neglect being righteous causes you to go into the era of judgmentalism and criticism and being critical of others. A person who stresses that they are righteous, acceptable to God because they keep certain laws, often judge and censor other people. They feel that rules and regulations, let me tell you something. You shouldn't be trying to judge nobody but yourself. Let God's word do the work on the other person. Not you. You're not God. You don't know their thoughts. You don't know what they're going through. You don't know what's going on with them. You don't know how God is working with them. God slow walks all of us. And if you really want to look at yourself, you can see how there's sometimes he got you there fast, but the other times he had to get you there slow because you was disobedient. I guess I done stepped on somebody's toes now. But while I'm stepping on yours, baby, I'm stepping on mine too. Okay? You cannot judge and censor others. These kind of people feel the rules and regulations can be kept because they keep them. Therefore, anybody who fails to keep them is judged by them, criticized by them, and censored by them. But the problem with this stress is that it too causes a false righteousness. Again, righteousness in the Bible is being righteous and doing righteousness. The Bible knows nothing of being acceptable to God without being made righteous in Jesus Christ. And the answer to righteousness is not what most of us think when we think of righteousness. When most of us think of righteousness, we think of doing good deeds, good works, helping our fellow man. As we walk through life, we face appeal after appeal for help, and we help. And we'll feel comfortable with ourselves because we've helped people. We feel our good deeds make us an acceptable and righteous before God. But the Bible is not saying that people never do good. It is saying that people are not righteous, not perfectly righteous within their hearts. None of us are perfectly righteous. Only Jesus. And we should strive every day for that. Notice Christ does not say, blessed are the righteous, for no one is righteous. He says, blessed are they who hunger and thirst after righteousness. Mankind is not righteous. Not perfectly righteous. That chance to be righteous is gone. mankind has already come short and missed the mark. All have missed the mark. We are already imperfect. Mankind has but one hope, that God will love us so much that he will somehow count us righteous. And that's why he sent Jesus. That's what God does. God takes our hunger and thirst after righteousness and counts that hunger and thirst as righteousness. God does this because he loves us. He said, because why? They will be filled. Why they will be, in the ESV it says, they will be satisfied. They shall be satisfied. The NIV says they will be filled. Being righteous and doing righteousness. That's what it means to be filled. And the question we must ask, we must all ask, is this. How much am I seeking after righteousness? Am I seeking at all? Am I seeking a little? Seeking some? Seeking much? Seeking more and more? What Christ says is this. We have to crave, starve, and thirst after righteousness. We must seek righteousness more and more if we wish to be filled and satisfied. Does that make sense to you out there on Facebook? Yes, we are all sinners saved by God's grace. But we must constantly hunger and thirst after more and more righteousness. All of us have some pull and some influence that urge us to do good. The pull and influence need to be nourished. In fact, it has to be nurtured, or else it weakens. And it can be subdued and weakened so much that it's killed off completely. It's hardened against doing anything except what self wants to do. And all of us know that within ourselves. We all know that. Righteousness is the only thing that will fill and satisfy man's innermost need. And because of Jesus, because he went to the cross and shed his blood, poured out his spirit upon us. That's why righteousness is the only thing that will fill and satisfy man's innermost need. And that righteousness doesn't come from us, it comes from Christ. Food and drink won't do it. And any honest and thinking person knows that there's nothing anywhere on this earth that can meet our deep need for life. Permanent life, I'm talking about. I'm talking about eternal life. I'm talking about Zoe life, abundant life. Only God can fill a life and satisfy the deep need for permanent life. This is the reason Christ says to hunger and thirst. And come back to it. Hunger and thirst after righteousness. He says, blessed, approved are you. Who hunger and thirst after, those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. They shall be satisfied. Being filled means to be filled with the Spirit of God, the Spirit of Christ, the fruit of the Spirit. It says in Galatians 5, 22 and 23 is love, joy, peace, and et cetera, et cetera. Righteousness. What is right? What do you mean, preacher? What do you mean when you say righteousness? In the Bible, righteousness means to simple, profound things. It has a double meaning. It means to be right and to do right. It may be said another way, to be good and to do good. This is critically important in the Bible. Romans 3:10 says there is none righteous, no, not one. Matthew 19 says there's, Jesus said there's none good, that is, but God, but one, that is God. Romans 3:23 says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And what is being said is that God alone is righteous. He alone is perfectly good. As a matter of fact, the word God comes from an old English word that means the good. It implies the absolute good. Man is not perfectly righteous. We come short. How can we become perfectly righteous? What's the answer? The answer is that Christ says, blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. And what happens is this. God takes a person's hunger and thirst after righteousness and counts it as righteousness. The person is not righteous, but God counts him or her as righteous. This is the great love of God. A person hungers and thirsts after righteousness, therefore God fills them. Several things need to be said again about righteousness. Righteousness is explained throughout Scripture in the word faith. Faith is believing God and trusting the goodness of God to take our faith and count it as righteousness. Look what Hebrews 11:6 says. Without faith, it's what? Impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that, listen to this, diligently seek him. That's hungering and thirsting after righteousness. It is the person who diligently seeks God, who really believes God. The man or woman who so hungers and thirsts after God and his righteousness shall be counted righteous, and they shall be filled. The righteousness of God has been shown to mankind. Just what God wants mankind to be and to do has been demonstrated perfectly in Jesus Christ. And this is the love of God. God has not given man just the written word describing his righteousness. He's given us a life, the life of his own son, to show what he means by righteousness. Jesus the Christ, the anointed one, is perfect righteousness. He did nothing but good. This is what the Bible means when it, and people say, I ain't Jesus. We know. But you got a hunger to be like him. And God says he'll fill you. This is what the Bible means when it talks about Christ being the righteousness of God, the pattern, the very image of righteousness, of being right and of doing right. Christ Jesus, 1 Corinthians 1:30, who of God is made unto us righteousness, the righteousness of God in Christ. Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith. righteousness involves, listen to this, the mind. Scripture says it involves being renewed in the spirit of your mind. Wow. Ephesians 4:23. And being renewed, Colossians 3:10 says, and being renewed in knowledge. What does that mean? That simply means that the person who seeks after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. They put on the new man, the new person, and they are renewed in the spirit of their mind. Another way to say that same thing is this. The one who seeks after God is put off the old man with his deeds and has put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created it. That's Colossians 3, verses 9 through 10. So, righteousness, that's what righteousness is. What is that filled life? The abundant life. The believer who hungers and thirsts after righteousness is wonderfully filled with both abundant life and eternal life. They're full of goodness, filled with all knowledge. Romans 15:14. They're filled with all the fullness of God. Ephesians 3:19. If I'm going too fast, say something, I'll slow down and repeat those scriptures.
Repeat the scriptures. Ephesians
3:19. Okay. Then Ephesians 5:18 said they are filled with the Spirit. Philippians 1:11. They are filled with the fruits of righteousness. Philippians 1:11. Filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. Wow. They're filled with the knowledge of God's will. And all of this is because the Spirit compels us to study the Word of God. They're filled with joy and with the Holy Ghost. Acts 13:52. The Holy Ghost. We'll be filled with life and have life abundant. We're filled with abundant life and eternal life. We are filled, let me say it like this, we are filled with God. Ain't that something? That's shouting time there. Filled with God. God is with us forever. I heard him say, I'll never leave you or forsake you. I read that somewhere. Did you read it? You know, excuse me, y'all. Partaking of the Word of God is like eating this ice cream. I looked down and saw it, and I had to give a bite. I'm sorry. Bad pastor, bad. But the Word of God is like something wonderful on your taste buds. The Bible says, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Right. Are there any questions, any comments tonight?
Yes, I did have one.
Okay.
Himself before our Father.
Yeah, ooh, 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 yes. Yes, he lived an example.
Yes, he did.
Of being in the kingdom of God. That means he submitted his total self. Everything he gave to God.
Right?
He committed it all to the Lord. And that's what we are to do. Commit it all. Hunger and thirst after righteousness. Anybody on Facebook want to make? I see your comments out there. It's beautiful. Abundant life. Holding on to God's unchanging hand. I see you. And this hunger and thirst after righteousness causes us to live a different way.
Yes.
And you see the evil and darkness of sin, and you want that out of your life. And you want more and more of Christ, more and more of God, more the Father, more and more of the Holy Ghost. And he fills us. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Shall we pray? Father, we thank you for your word. Lord, we thank you that you put it in us to hunger and thirst for righteousness, to whole righteousness, to be righteous and to do righteousness. Continue to touch us, O God, with that hunger and thirst, that we may be filled. Fill us right now till we overflow, that others would come to you and see you dwelling in us and be drawn to you as the moth is to the flame. Lord God, we'll be careful to give you praise, glory, and honor with our being righteous and our doing righteousness. And we ask it all, pray it all, in the mighty matchless name, nature, and character of Jesus the Christ, your darling son. And for your glory we say, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Love each and every one of you. Yes, love each and every one of you. I'll see you, some of you tomorrow on the morning meditation. I love y'all. Y'all take care. Be blessed. Dream holy dreams. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Keep your mind stayed on Jesus. And eventually, if you're not dreaming those holy dreams yet, eventually you will. Be blessed. Take care.
Yes. Enjoy your ice cream, Pastor.
I will. I might have to get another couple of scoops. I don't know. Amen. Take care. Be blessed, y'all.